When we talk about sleep stages, you know, it's a little bit more complicated than most people think, because you've got wake, which is not really a sleep stage, but you drift into drowsiness and then you move into light sleep. Light sleep lasts for a lot of the night, not all in one block because we have sleep cycles, but it's typically about half your night's sleep. And you can be in light sleep or deep light sleep. And unfortunately, when sleep is staged, it's just called light sleep. But yet, if you're very close to deep sleep, that's better sleep, better quality sleep, than if you're just on the verge of drowsiness and you just drifted into light sleep. So it's really important, and what we do is we basically look at light sleep and also deep sleep, and that's all considered non-REM sleep. That's not dream sleep. And that sleep we look at and we grade it in terms of its overall quality. And so we're much more granular in our analysis of that to know how restorative your sleep is. Sleep stages were first defined in 1967 by two researchers, Rechtschaffen and Kales. And they actually defined seven different stages of sleep. But in 2008, that staging classification was changed to be made much simpler. So the way people look at sleep staging now is to divide things up into light sleep, deep sleep, and dream sleep. So they made it pretty simple. It used to be that drowsiness was considered very light sleep, and so that used to be considered stage one, and then you moved into stage two that was light sleep. And then deep sleep was also divided into two stages with the old scheme, delta three and delta four. Again, those are versions of deep sleep, but right now it's just called deep sleep. And then there's dream sleep, and the brainwave patterns in dream sleep look like wake almost. And that's very, very different in terms of the level of sleep. Nothing like deep sleep, but that's where you have your dreams, although you can have some dreams out of what's called REM sleep or dream sleep. The wearables, you know, the wrist wearables, the ring wearables, they're very interesting in that, you know, most of them do some level of sleep staging. And there's good and there's bad related to sleep staging from a wearable versus true polysomnography in a sleep lab. When you look at what's done in a sleep lab to stage sleep, they measure brain waves, eye movements, chin muscle activity. Those are the three main parameters that allow sleep scientists as well as polysomnographers to identify the different sleep stages. Well, when you're using a wearable, you're not measuring anybody's brain waves, you're not looking at their chin muscle activities, and you're definitely not looking at eye movements. So then you have to say, oh, wait a minute, how can they possibly stage sleep without measuring these brainwaves, eye movements, and chin muscle activity? And it's done through heart rate variability and motion. And so a whole different set of metrics to stage sleep. And that's very convenient because you don't have to get all wired up with electrodes to do that measurement. But there are some downsides to it. The problem that you run into in measuring sleep from a wearable, you know, without EEG, eye movements, chin muscle activity, is that without brain waves, it's hard to know the differentiation between wake, where you have nice alpha activity, or beta activity, which is even faster, versus drowsiness, light sleep even, or dream sleep. Because you can be lying in bed, very quiet, and remember the wearable, if you're not moving your arm, It's not going to register any motion. And if you're very quiet and very calm and resting, your heart rate variability is going to be very constant. And so from the wearable's perspective, it's very difficult to differentiate. And so all of the wearables have some problem in differentiating wake from different aspects of sleep. Regarding wearables and sleep, the really good thing about it is you can measure it night after night after night and get a trend and really understand relative to all these nights, you know, yeah, this week I slept really well. And now, you know, I was a little stressed out at work. I had these financial concerns and it really showed up in my sleep. You can't do that kind of thing in a sleep lab because you're not going to go sleep in a sleep lab every night. First of all, it's extremely expensive. Secondly, who wants to go into a sleep lab and get wired up every night? So totally impractical. But the wearable, hey, slip it on, put on the ring, you know, use the wearable on your wrist, and you get this nightly recording that has a tremendous amount of value. Some people ask us, well, you've got this interesting therapeutic device, and it operates, you place it under the bed, it generates different frequencies from the magnetic field, and you run it using your wearable. Well, weren't there already wearables on the marketplace that you could have just teamed up with? And, you know, the answer was yes, and we actually contacted some of the manufacturers. But we wanted to look at heart rate variability the way they were looking at it, plus in what's called the frequency domain. And right now, all the wearables look at it in the time domain, which is essentially the standard deviation of beat-to-beat intervals. And that provides useful information, but the frequency domain analysis of heart rate variability provides much more information. And we wanted to have all of that to be able to assess sleep. Since we use our wearable for two different reasons, one is to change what happens during sleep, and the other is to look at sleep in the morning and basically have greater accuracy as to how you slept, we end up using the different aspects of heart rate variability for one versus the other function. For instance, to monitor sleep during the night and then have the wearable say, hey, you know what? They're moving into deep sleep now, so we want to run these specific frequencies to enhance deep sleep. We don't need all the fancy frequency-based heart rate variability analysis. So we can just rely on the time-based analysis. The interesting aspect of that is all the wearables on the marketplace, that's what they do. They do the time-based analysis. So we're at a point now where we could work with some of those companies, incorporate a software or firmware module so that they could actually use their wearable to run our generator. The reason we really like the frequency-based heart rate variability analysis is we can compare the time-based and frequency-based information, and that gives us a lot of information about certain issues in sleep that aren't apparent if you just use time-based analysis. So for instance, if there's a difference between the two curves that we get, you know, time-based and frequency-based, it's like, wait a minute, what's happening there? Because normally you want to see them parallel one another. And what we've learned is when the time-based is high and the frequency-based is low, it's almost as if the brainstem, the primitive part of the nervous system that regulates sleep, is saying, hey, go into deep sleep. But the other aspect is saying, sorry, you know, I don't want to go there yet. I still want to think about the issues I'm having. And therefore, that curve stays higher. Well, I can tell you right now, that's not the same level of restorative sleep.